Hey, everybody, and welcome back. This is Backcountry Hunters and Anglers Podcast and Blast. I'm Hal Herring, and I wanted to record a quick introduction to this one. As you know, if you listen to the podcast before, sometime we don't want to kind of flatter our guests there and embarrass them with a recitation of all their vast accomplishments. And the same thing is here today with my podcast with Rudy Raceline of Raceline Alternative Energy and Raceline Farms in Missouri. He's based in Missouri. Just a little background. For 2 years ago, my good friend Brandon Butler was director of Conservation Federation of Missouri, and he invited me to come down to Jeff City there and speak to a gathering of the federation there. And Brandon has since gone to work for Rudy Raceline, proving again that he's maintaining his position on the cutting edge of American conservation. And I don't say that lightly. Brandon is a touchstone for me in trying to understand where we are in America with conservation, and his position there, and Rudy's place there in Missouri, in the heart of America, in truly a state which has defined America over and over again from before the Civil War to now. So Brandon introduced me 2 years ago to Rudy Raceline, and I spent a couple of days with Rudy then, basically just listening to a man who is redefining American agriculture and alternative energy at the same time. It is a vision which could not come at a better time, and it comes from a man who I would we'll talk about this in a podcast, but Rudy's origins on the war devastated landscapes of Europe in post World War II, to the kind of hard streets and back alleys of St. Louis, Missouri, where he landed as a very young boy, and learned to hunt rabbits along the Mississippi River and range far into his own path in developing a global business, and having another awakening in China, where he was working, that the world is very crowded and things are going fairly badly for our ecosystems and our wildlife and the environment which supports our every endeavor. And Rudy's awakening there in China to eventually come back to the United States and start re-envisioning a way for humankind to work with natural systems in a sort of symbiotic relationship rather than this constantly losing conflict. One of the things he's done, of course, at Raceline Alternative Energy is to pioneer methane capture on these huge hog manure lagoons, producing clean burning natural gas from what was simply a dangerous effluent. He's now working towards a vision to restore 30 million acres of American prairie and native plants while giving American farmers a multi-layered market system to control their own destinies and to retake their own profits and commodities. It's a genius vision, and it comes from a lifetime of Rudy's successful re-envisioning of systems. I'll let him tell the story from here on out. But on this podcast, which I consider one of the most important I have ever done, I'll make an unusual request, perhaps. I would be more than appreciate hearing from anybody who listens to this podcast and let me know what you think. I'm deeply engaged in this vision, and I'd like to see what other folks think of it. So with that, I'll leave it to you. Thanks for being here. Hope you enjoy it. Talk soon. See you out there. The end of living and the beginning of survival. When you lose all these things that we're talking about, we haven't had to face that as Americans yet, but it's faced every day all over the world.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And why would we choose that?
But I'm happy to wake up, talk to you today, make a difference, and hopefully our conversation today can get people to think about, you know, is what we're doing today really the solution? And say, look, this is not a threat. This is a huge opportunity to do something different that provides another dimension for farmers and for agriculture and for energy and for the environment and for our wildlife, and look at it in a way that they're not competing.
Right.
They can be symbiotic things that they ought to be, because you can't separate them. There's no way to separate these things and put them in silos and say, I'm going to do this and it's not going to affect that. It all affects each other.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back. This is Backcountry Hunters and Anglers Podcast and Blast. I'm Hal Herring. I am in Putnam County, Missouri. And we're about 10 or 12 miles from the Iowa line.
That's exactly right.
We're on Rudy Raceline's farm. We've been out this morning looking at some prescribed burning. They are restoring prairie and making habitat for big white-tailed deer and turkeys and everything else in between, pollinators. And I mean, it's a fantastic part of the world and a fantastic project. I mean, I've 2 years ago we met, and I've been trying to get back here ever since. So, Rudy, tell me, I guess, introduce yourself and Raceline Energy and what you're working on here, and then we'll go a little bit deeper into how you got here.
Well, thank you, Hal. I really appreciate the opportunity to have you here. At, you know, I've got this farm in central Missouri that you visited a few years ago that, from my German descent, we call Himmel's Way. Well, Himmel is a German word that means heaven. And I guess this is Himmel's Way number two, because it is a little bit of heaven. And I have to tell you, I bought this farm 12 years ago on a purely selfish reason. We've got really big beer here in northern Missouri, and it started out just as that. You know, I wanted to grow some really big deer. But I've also, you know, had the good fortune of immigrating to this country at a pretty young age, and feel like I'm really privileged to be in this country. And the other privilege I've had is traveling all over the world, and so I've seen an awful lot of things in the 40 years that I've traveled all over the world, building these high-tech beverage aluminum can plants and many other different type of industrial facilities all over the world. And so my love of wildlife kind of made me look at things maybe in a different perspective, because I've seen ancient cultures in China and other countries and what's happened to the landscape, what's happened to the streams and rivers as a result of overpopulation and the pressure that population puts on food, it puts on energy, it puts on living spaces, it puts on infrastructure of highways and roads, and all of those things that are industrial development that make our economic engines move, but also have a, you know, great impact on the environment. And so my philosophy has been, you know, how can we bring those things together where they're not really at odds? How can we recognize land as something that produces more than parkways and high rises and bridges? And but also, you know, in agriculture, you know, is there things that it does in agriculture that serve society and the landowner better than what it's currently doing? Are there some things that it's currently doing that maybe we need to survive as a planet? And so this farm has kind of become that experiment. I don't tell farmers what to do. I don't ask them to do what I do, because I don't make my living working as hard as they do from the land. And so all I'm trying to do is use this farm as an experiment to look at, you know, can we grow beans? Can we grow barn? Where can we grow them? Can we do it economically? And then where else can I intersperse other types of plants and vegetation to potentially provide a different solution to make a little bit of income, to say, yeah, that this land also serves society, but it serves me as a landowner, and I can do it in a way that other farmers could potentially make a living from it.
And your Raceline Energy is integrated into that completely. I mean, I know you've got a restoration project here, and it goes beyond. I know with Pheasants Forever, we talk about farm the best and conserve the rest. And I know you do that, but you're also talking about farming the best and also producing some income off the rest, and with incentives for farmers biomass and also just in ecosystem services.
Right. And so, you know, again, I made my living as a poor immigrant that came here with nothing. I guess you could say I'm an example of the American dream. My parents came here in 1956 from Europe. I lived very, very humbly the early years of my life in Austria as an immigrant. My parents came from Yugoslavia. They really weren't, you know, wanted in Austria or anywhere. And so we lived in the displacement camps that you see now, these young, whether it's Syrian or Lebanese kids and all these kids that are in displacement camps. I lived that life. And so I came here and I felt very fortunate. But I was always somebody that worked very hard, and I've been able to build a business. And this business has actually proliferated aluminum beverage cans all over the world, which I think is one of the most sustainable packages. We happen to have 75% of any aluminum can that's still in that product 25 years later because it's recyclable. We're currently on a mission to replace 450 billion units of single-serve plastic in the next 10 years with aluminum beverage cans that are totally recyclable. And that industry has allowed me to do some things economically that I probably wouldn't have. I mean, I have spent a significant amount of money on this farm, but also it allowed me to look at technologies that I've seen. And so I saw this technology 10, 15 years ago that was developing Europe called anaerobic digestion. And what it was doing was taking animal waste and turning that animal waste into a renewable natural gas in Germany and Austria and Italy and many of the European countries. Their goal was to have three different sources of renewable energy. They were using solar systems, they were using wind, and they were also generating electricity from renewable natural gas. So there's a process called anaerobic digestion. It is a natural process. The last stage of that process is a microbial bug that is called a methanogen, and it creates methane.
A methanogen?
It's called a methanogen, and it actually creates methane after three different stages prior to that pass on the microbial residues to that methanogen, and then the last stage, it creates methane. In addition to methane, it also creates some carbon dioxide, it creates some hydrogen sulfide, and a few other impurities. So the task really is, how do you make 98 to 99% pure methane so that you have a molecule that, when you're looking at natural gas, it's essentially that same molecule. And so I studied the German model for quite a while, and at the same time, I was seeing some issues here in northern Missouri. At the time, there's a company called Premium Standard Farms. They were in a tremendous amount of litigation with the state, with the federals, and local people that said, hey, you know, you have all these giant lagoons. They had over 93 and 4-acre lagoons. They had 2 million hogs. So when you think of 2 million hogs, I mean, that's a pig that grows from 45 pounds to 285 pounds. When it's done, you're talking about a tremendous amount of urine and feces that is going into an open pit. And so rightly so, the neighbors were upset with the odor. But when that company built this area of northern Missouri was one of the least populated areas of the entire country on a per mile basis. And so they were trying to do it in an area that was not very populated, but also where land values were still around $300 an acre, so they could buy a significant amount of acreage to buffer themselves. But as time went on, people moved in, and so there was this conflict, like many times we see all over the world, where people start to move in, and what was there 10 years ago doesn't work now because now people have different expectations. And as I went to the restaurants and I listened to the love and hate relationship, you know, they loved the fact that it represented thousands of jobs up here, but they hated the fact that they had a smell, and in the summertime they couldn't sit outside because of the odor. There were flies, there was excrement going into the streams and rivers. So it ended up in a long litigation of almost spending $100 million. And I kept thinking about this and said, you know, is there something that you can do with all the knowledge that you've had in building breweries and all these chemical plants?
Did you own this farm at that time?
I did. I bought it in 98. Sure. And I did it because I wanted to hunt big deer.
Yeah.
And I wanted it as a place to escape. I mean, I led a pretty, I would say, intense life doing what I do. You know, I've traveled all over the world. In fact, I've had people kidnapped in Nigeria. I've had, you know, issues in Russia. And wherever I go, it's a lot of conflict. And so I wanted a place to hide. I wanted a place to hunt. I wanted a place that I can recharge my soul. And I can do that when I go for 2 or 3 days and I get into the woods and I get into the greater reason why we're all here. And I think about that. I get recharged. So I didn't have any of this in mind. But at the same time, I was sitting on a Missouri Prairie Foundation, and I was helping restore prairie because I really felt prairie was having a significant impact on my land for birds and for wildlife, and even deer and turkey. I mean, I see my deer come out at 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon because they feel really sheltered. They don't need to be in an area where they all secluded and you can't see them until, you know, 5 minutes after dark. And so I did it for those selfish reasons.
But can I ask you how you got into that, like Prairie Foundation, and like what inspired you to do all this? Like it's obviously been a driving engine of your life, was the natural world and stuff like that before you got into conveyance and engineering.
Well, it is a really great question. And like a lot of things in my life, you know, I feel like God's taken me on these crooked roads to where I get am today. And I have to say again, it was purely selfish. I had an opportunity with a friend of mine to hunt in Kansas. And one of the biggest deers I've ever harvested was over a 200-inch deer in the Flint Hills of Kansas. And so I bought my first farm when my best friend and I were just in our mid-20s. We didn't have much money, but we bought 100 acres together. And we started, like a lot of people, it was mostly forested, so we started making food plots. And we put clovers and we put legumes, and we were trying to do things to make our deer bigger and better. We went to supplemental feeding, and we did all these things. And then later on in life, I bought a bigger farm, the one you went at 500 acres in Osage County.
Right.
And we did the same thing. And so we were, you know, we were buying some of the best legumes that you could buy. We were looking at, you know, the marketing stuff out there. We were planting turnips, and we started early with food plots almost 25 years ago. But I went to Kansas, and in the middle of the Flint Hills, I killed this deer that's over 200 inches. And there's not a food plot anywhere. And there's not crops anywhere. I'm in the middle of Flint Hills, and I kill this giant deer.
The original tall grass.
Yeah. And I'm thinking, how can that be? You know? And so I really start studying these native grasses. And at the same time, I met a land conservationist from the Department, Missouri Department of Conservation, who I think is one of the best agencies in the country, a young lady by the name of Jennifer Batson, and she introduced me to the concept of, hey, I know your clover and your alfalfa and the things that you have are great, but you have them all the way up to the edge of your woods, and you don't have any edge. You don't have any what was called successional growth. And maybe you want to look at prairie. And I said, well, it's funny you say that, because I just killed this giant deer in Kansas, and I was just thinking about prairie. So she introduced me to a guy named Frank Oberle, who in this area has probably restored more prairie, and he owned a company called Pure Air Seed Company. And Frank was just an encyclopedia of information.
Yeah, I met him last night, and
awesome guy that really loves, breathes, and eats conservation, and looks at land management and how can we possibly do some of the things that we're doing up here in northern Missouri better. And so it was kind of that crooked road that got me to the point where, well, maybe I ought to plant more prairie. And then after I started doing it, I got an award for all the work I was doing, asked to join the Missouri Prairie Foundation. And it's because of the Missouri Prairie Foundation I heard about all the trials and tribulations. They actually planted 800 acres in cooperation with Premium Standard Farms. But then during one of the really wet years, they had to put effluent onto that. And the tribal knowledge at the time was, well, you can't put effluent on there because it's high in nitrogen. And if you do that, all it's going to do is make the grasses grow and your forbs and flowers and things, they're going to get subdued. And therefore, some of the funding that was available from the various departments would be taken away. And it was actually in violation of that. And so the guy that was the president of that organization, he was a lawyer, and he actually worked on an arrangement to eliminate that funding, and we all pitched in and made sure there were no issues with it, and we took care of that. But that gave me another thing to think about.
When you say take care of it, y'all actively engaged to solve this?
We engaged it and solved the problem with the Missouri Prairie Foundation, and the prairie is there today. In fact, we harvested thousands of dollars of seed off of that prairie. We used part of that prairie for a 1,000-acre restoration with the EDF for a 1,000-acre plot that we're working on.
EDF being Environmental Defense Fund.
A cooperation with Smithfield Family Foundation. We put 1,000 acres for monarchs down for the last 2 years. But, you know, back to the story is that as a result of that, I asked that president to introduce me to the executives at this company. And I went to him and I said, hey, listen, I think I have some ideas on how I might help this process. So we went into a 2-year program of how I thought we could potentially change what was happening up here. And at the time, you know, some of the market-based solutions that are available today were not available. Originally, the only thing that was available was carbon credits. So what I suggested first was that these 93-acre lagoons, I would cover them and turn them into anaerobic digesters, and then we would capture that gas and flare it. And then I would get about a 3 or 4% rate of return on doing that flaring.
And how do you get that return?
Through a program at the time that was called carbon credit. So if you eliminate methane, you think about methane, it's 30 times more destructive to the atmosphere than CO2.
Okay.
And so there was a carbon credit available through traders, and I sold that carbon credit. And as I flared that, I would get some money. So I spent, you know, on those covers about $350,000 per cover. I put in 40 some of them, so I spent a little over $12, $15 million putting those in, hoping to get about a 3 or... And while that was going on, we were developing the technology on how do we purify that gas to where we could use it either as electricity or potentially as a renewable natural gas that could go into the pipeline.
Okay.
Well, with electricity in Missouri, you only get what's called avoided costs. So the electricity company would say, okay, if I don't make this electricity, the avoided cost is about 3 or 4 cents a kilowatt hour. Well, there's no way that that would pay for this capital that we were going to have to go to the next step. And so what happened was California initiated a program called the Low Carbon Fuel Standard, where they said, hey, we want to get rid of the diesel in our cities. We want to get rid of a lot of the vehicular emissions that are going, which are much greater than what you would do if you would burn natural gas. Typically, if you burn natural gas very clean, you only get a byproduct of CO2 and very little other. You don't get carbon monoxide. You don't get some of the things that you get from diesel, some of which are carcinogenics, and they're trying to keep out of the municipalities in Missouri, or in California, rather. And so that market became available. The other thing that happened in 2015, the EPA classified manure as what's called a second generation potential for making fuel, and the cellulosic component, because they said we can only make X amount of fuel from corn and beans, and they plateaued that at about 15 billion gallons. And then the next thing that was supposed to happen was they were going to make ethanol from cellulosic material, which was corn stover and grasses and other things, but it couldn't be from food products. When they did that, they also classified manure as a cellulosic material, because when you think about it, it's all energy. You know, an animal eats the energy, it converts it into protein, but there's a residue left. And that residue that's left is still energy for this microbial community that can make gas. And so they looked at it and said, well, what's left is a cellulosic material.
Yeah.
And so that cellulosic material is still energy, and that energy is turned now into methane, but it has impurities. So while all this was going on, I studied the different technologies that were available, and what we ended up doing is kind of springboarding some technologies using a membrane. And think about a straw.
These technologies existed in some form in Germany, right?
Yeah, there's technologies that existed in Germany, but they were fairly sophisticated. The capital costs were still pretty high. And so what I looked at with my experience in a lot of different industries, and keep in mind, I mean, I've been involved in, you know, assisting in combustion engineering, building nuclear power plants. I'm an electrical engineer. I designed some of the early Intel 80 board-level systems that actually pull the cal rods out of the combustion engineering nuclear power plants. I've been involved in fusel plants. I've been involved in ethanol plants, chemical plants. But mostly my life has been around packaging, and, you know, I helped Campbell Soup convert from three-piece to two-piece cans. I helped convert the easy open end so, you know, women don't have to use an opener anymore. And so there's a lot of technology in my 40 or 50 years of engineering experience. And so I just studied what was there and said, you know, how can we improve this? How can we reduce the capital cost? How can we make it? And so we actually developed a gas purification system that we've now deployed that allows us to be fairly economical at various scales.
Okay.
And so what we've been able to do is half of the 9 finishing farms up here, we now have converted and we're producing gas. But the ultimate goal is to say, okay, now that we've done it with manure, which is the low-hanging fruit, how much of that can we do with 70 million pigs? How much can we do with 10 million dairy? Can we do it with all the other poultry? But beyond that, my real dream is that how much landscape could we convert and make biomass that not only makes biomass that makes gas, because we know now we have the technology to do that, but a mixture of grasses and forbs that provide ecological services. And by that, I mean every piece of land, whether a farmer's getting paid or not, think of our body. We have livers, we have kidneys, we have intestines. All of that allows our brain, and the thing that really makes us function as a human, is taken for granted. Our skeleton's taken for granted until you have something like I've had for the last 3 weeks where something goes wrong and it breaks.
Yeah.
And I think we're at that stage where the planet is in such pain, we're starting to pay attention. Just like 3 weeks ago, I had to start paying attention to some things that are happening to my body at 72 and saying, hey, maybe you're not taking care of it as well as you have. And so when we see the fires, when I see what I've seen all over the world, it's made me aware a long time ago, but I think society is so busy living, and the majority of society is so busy trying to raise kids and make money and, you know, arguing about the things that we don't recognize the pain. You know, one of the manifestations that I've predicted for years is happening right now, and it's a result of the biosecurity issues that I've always seen in China and some other countries where how food is handled. You know, most people aren't aware, but the Chinese lost a significant portion of their 700 million pigs in the last 3 years because of African swine fever.
Okay.
They have another avian flu fever, but now we have this coronavirus. Those are all manifestations of an environmental issue that is starting to surface itself. It's just like if you and I go to Mexico or if we go to another country, we have a microbial community in our stomach that's used to certain kinds of food and water. And even if it's not, you know, going to kill us, it's going to affect those bugs to the point where for a week or two, maybe we got some serious problems that we don't want to deal with while we're on vacation. Same thing with what I see with planting all of the different types of crops that we're planting. Most of those crops are not indigenous to our country. And all this microbial community that lives below the soil, they're not used to interfacing and providing a symbiotic relationship with those roots. My own farm, I always wonder, why do I have this terrible erosion? And I think it's mostly where I have corn and beans, where I've replanted natives. Over time, I've been able to control that erosion.
Yeah.
Where I have corn and beans, even when I plant cover crops to a certain degree, I still see erosion. And I think part of that is that the living organisms below the soil are not holding it and bonding it together. And so this intricate relationship between agriculture and our soil and the amount of clean air and clean water that we have is what concerns me. And so my promotion is that, well, let's look at where we really ought to be planting corn and beans and other crops that provide the food that we need and the return. But let's look at the value of the other property and say, if it's providing, you know, flood prevention, if it's providing clean air and clean water, pulling the phosphorus and all this sediment and nitrogen out of our water, and we're spending billions and billions of dollars on flooding, we're spending billions and billions of dollars on water treatment facilities, why not society spend it upstream on a per acre basis with a farmer and prevent it?
Yeah.
And just stop it before it ever happens, just like holistic medicine that you sometimes see in the Eastern countries. They're saying, hey, let's not spend billions on cancer treatment. Let's spend billions on what's causing the cancer and figure out, let's not do that.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, the mission here is to say, okay, we have to have commercial solutions. Otherwise, industry's not going to pay for it. And, you know, the situation I had with Smithfield was, they had spent over $100 million. They had six or seven major projects that all failed.
That Premium was bought by Smithfield.
Premium Standard Farms was bought. Originally, they named it Murphy Brown because that was the hog production division of Smithfield.
Okay.
And so once they sold it, and then they brought all the brands up to a certain standard. So now it's all called Smithfield Food Production. But originally, it was Premium Standard. And they bought into something that, you know, was a legacy here.
And a legacy of problems as well.
A lot of problems. And in fact, you know, there was a period 3 or 4 years ago, I thought that possibly they were thinking about selling it. There's a great article in Successful Farming about this whole process that we went through. And they gave me significant credit for potentially adding these on.
And, you gave me a copy of that. I've got it on my desk.
Yeah. So there's a long article about, you know, the succession and what happened, and it's all about, you know, the legacy of this premium standard farms and what happened. And I don't want to dwell too much on that other than to say I think the Smithfield management all the way up to their CEO, Ken Sullivan, their board of directors have been very, very supportive once they saw that, you know, I wasn't, you know, either going to go away because it was difficult or that this was another technological boondoggle.
Yeah.
So we've proven to them over time. And so the great thing now is we're a 50-50 partner. They've just committed another $45 million to finish the next phase. And by 2021, you know, we're going to have the largest animal conversion facility in the country producing renewable natural gas. But more importantly, they're committed to the other side of it as well. They want to have their 45,000 acres. We're planting native grasses around our lakes. They feed their pigs from that water. We're purifying their water. They want to do experimentation with the biomass to actually incorporate this Horizon 2, where we produce not only gas, but we produce ecological services. We've engaged Iowa State University to help us study. We've engaged other outside consultants that are going to put probes on my farm to look at carbon sequestration on fescue land, on farmland, on prairie land, and on different quadrants of my farm so we get sound statistical data. We've had Missouri University doing water studies and saying how much erosion are we get. We have these water sampling systems out here to say how much soil are we losing, you know, how much water runoff are we getting at various types. So I had the good fortune to have the money to spend that. I have not asked for TIF. I have not asked for tax abatement. I've just
What is TIF?
It's when you go in and you ask, you know, for certain tax abatement from your state or federal government, and they fund up a lot of this stuff with federal or state funds. And I've not asked for that. I just went out and spent $57 million of my own damn money.
Which is nice. Like, nice to be able to do. But if you do that and you set the stand and you create a new standard that works, then TIF and all that other stuff can come in for smaller players who want to be in part of it.
Well, again, and rather than do that, what we went is we said, hey, we're going to prove this. And for 3 years I worked with, there's a Farm Credit Bureau that actually provides assistance to farmers, and it's specifically for farmers. And there's a company called CoBank. So we've met with CoBank, and we now have a $45 million loan. The equity that I have put in, the equity that Smithfield, which is over $70 million, allowed us to get a $45 million loan to finish the next phase.
And the next phase is?
The next phase is two additional farms that we hope to have actually finished by the end of this summer. And then next year, there's going to be three more farms, which are another $45 million that will finish by the end of 2021.
Yeah.
Once we do that, we'll have about, you know, roughly 2.2 million hogs producing renewable natural gas. Hundreds of thousands of homes can be powered by that gas. Several, you know, hundreds of thousands of gallons of well, actually 1.2 million gallons of diesel will be displaced by that. Instead of having diesel, we'll have renewable natural gas. But the second phase of that is that very slowly we want to increment using this biomass from both cover crops and from prairie grasses. My vision is that if we could restore 30 million acres along the Mississippi and Missouri riverways in critical areas, harvest those grasses on a very, I would say, complementary to wildlife. And by that, I mean, let's look at when we have our breeding season for rabbits and quail and deer and all those things. Let's harvest at a point where it has minimal impact to that. But we also have to look at when can we harvest for the sustainability of those grasses, because they have to grow enough after you harvest so that the nutrients go back down into the roots and you don't, with 2 or 3 years of harvesting, destroy them.
You bet.
And what we have found is that if we do that from the middle of July until about the middle of August, it's kind of a good compromise between all those systems. We've actually done what's called biomass testing and biomethane. So by that, we mean we go out and silage in the summer. We send that silage to laboratories. they test how much do we get per acre. And I think when I drove you around today, we get about, on this farm in a good year of 36 to 42 inches, we get it somewhere between 7 and 10 tons per acre.
This is on an average year, say 42 inches of rain?
Yeah, we get, you know, up here, we do typically get somewhere between 36 and 42 inches. Unfortunately, we don't always get it an inch per week like
right.
we should.
Well, if you've got prairie cover, you can take eight, right?
Yeah.
Well, what were you telling me that you could take a deluge? This kind of deluge we get now if you have native prairie on the ground.
Yeah, and keep in mind that's on a large expanse. You know, we have plots here that, you know, we got 100 acres of this, and so we still have. So I still see that these deluges here, because it's not one large expanse of prairie, doesn't give me that kind of absorption rate. But there are data that shows that in the original prairie, in fact, there's a great article about one of the rivers in Illinois, the Des Plaines River, and it actually has historical data. It was not navigable 120 years ago because it was prairie, and the prairie would absorb so much of the water, there was not enough runoff. And so I think we see that there's so many areas of our country in Canada that have these prairie names that used to be, you know, massive amounts of prairie.
Yeah.
But when you had that kind of coverage, when you got a significant rain, because of the root systems, it would actually, you know, infiltrate that water, and that water wouldn't necessarily surge. And then slowly it would go back out into the streams, and you had streams running all summer.
Right.
You know, I think the great breaks that you have in your beautiful state of Montana is a prime example. We talked today about, you know, Richard's comment about those ponds actually giving people safes in a community or in a income level that has no money to put in the safe.
Right. This is Dick Manning's book, right?
Yeah,
Richard Manning's book.
I think it's a great historical novel about, you know, the yeoman and moving the concept of everyone owning 40 or 80 acres and trying to subsist off of that west. And it might have worked great here in the east, but as you move west and you didn't have the rainfall and people were still trying to do things the same way, it just didn't work.
Right.
We did the same thing during the Dust Bowl. You know, we moved west and we decimated a great part of the plains trying to grow wheat.
And we grew it. And the bushel price was nothing.
Yeah. Well, you know, prior to the war and during the war, bushel prices were great. But then after the war stopped and all of a sudden that one little instant or 4 or 5 year blip where you had great rains and they actually convinced people that, look, if you plant wheat, it's going to make it rain.
Right.
Well, that sure was proven to be a fallacy. But the point is that, you know, I look at land and say, you know, how do we make a living off that land?
Yeah.
Well, sometimes you can't make a living off what agriculture dictates how you should do it. You have to look at it and say, what other value does it have? Is it providing more value in preventing flooding? Is it providing more value in sequestering carbon and, you know, infiltrating nutrients that aren't going into our streams and rivers that are poisoning our kids?
Right.
That are having to spend billions of dollars to purify that water at cities and municipalities. And so I think that's where society has to look at. And after traveling all over the world, and I'm grateful to be an immigrant in this country, this country needs to take leadership. We can't wait for these other countries to do this. And I don't think it's something that's going to cost us money. What I'm excited about is I see these young kids that I have working for me that come to me teary-eyed and said, you know what? If it weren't for this technology, if it weren't for these job opportunities, I wouldn't be living at home in northern Missouri.
Right.
I might be in Atlanta. I might be in Kansas City. But I wouldn't be here.
You bet.
And so if we take that times a thousandfold all over rural America and revitalize rural America with new technologies, a new way of looking at land, it doesn't have to be a financial drain on our country. It can be what I proved to Smithfield. It's an additive source of income to their, and it eliminates a lot of problems. It eliminates odor. It eliminates rainfall into their city.
And I'm going to go back with Brandon Butler, who got me in here. But Brandon had made a note here. It's like keeping methane out of the atmosphere with a market-based solution.
Yeah, and that's exactly right. You know, we're not going to stop producing. These people that are talking about we're going to stop eating meat.
Right.
I'm sorry. We have, you know, we're carnivores. And I happen to like meat. There's a lot of other people that are not going to stop eating meat. There's cultures that live off of meat. So to think that 7.5 or 8 billion people are going to stop eating meat and we're going to stop producing methane, what are we going to do with all those animals? We're going to slaughter them and kill them, and they're not going to stop producing? No, I think there's going to be some continuation. Now, should our diets change? Absolutely. As we evolve, I think we will change. But you have to look at what I call mass and energy balances. And I tell my grandkids all this time that want to become vegans, if you substitute other foods, what is the mass and energy balance? What are you doing to the landscape to produce that food versus producing protein? And if it means that more and more landscape needs to go into agriculture, is that better? I'm not sure that it is. And so,
well, especially given the kind of model of agriculture we have now, which is killing us.
Yeah,
in my opinion.
The other thing that I hear a lot of negative things about CAFOs, but what people have to recognize is that the CAFOs have reduced the amount of feed that goes into a particular animal, whether it's a pig or whether it's chicken. The amount of feed that has to be produced is so much more efficient and not wasted. And the amount of landscape that it would take to put 2.5 million or 2 million pigs back on the landscape would be devastating to this northern Missouri region.
Yeah.
I see it with the cattle.
CAFO being a concentrated animal feeding operation.
Yes, gotcha. Exactly. Okay. Exactly. And so you drove around up here. You saw some of the cattle operations. You saw the amount of dirt and things when you have cattle. And see, people say, well, we need to grow more grass. Well, up here, our grass doesn't grow for 4 or 5 months out of the year.
Yeah.
And so what you have is, you know, confined animal units anyway. They're just not in buildings. They just happen to be on a landscape, tearing up the landscape, and feces and manure is being washed into our streams and rivers. And so, you know, the production of that protein takes up landscape. I think the CAFOs have just made it very efficient. And it's very controversial. But I look at it and say, you know, it's a food production facility. The animals that I've seen are very well cared for. The facilities that we work at are extremely clean, and you know, we now have lots of compliments from the neighbors. Hey, there's no odor anymore. We don't see the kind of problems, and so I see it as a significant improvement. But most importantly, we have a market-based solution that takes a problem and now turns it into a source of income that makes something that was marginally profitable that maybe went out of business into something that can still subsist.
Yeah. And so I kind of interrupted you when you were talking about making the membrane that the methane passes through to make it into a purer form of natural gas. But one of the things I wanted to get into was you got Horizon 1, Horizon 2, and Horizon 3 on your video. And for anybody listening to this, it's Raceline Energy. Can you just Google up Raceline Energy and get that video?
Yeah, it's actually Raceline Alternative Energy.
Okay, RAE.
So, yeah, RAE, Raceline Alternative Energy. There's a number of videos on that particular website. One of them is the one that we all watched this morning that gives a general overview. That's roughly 10 minutes. There's a couple smaller ones. And then there's some if you go to my farm where you see, I'm a prolific photographer. I've gotten to the point I like taking pictures and videos more than I like just harvesting animals. But, you know, part of the process for me has been it's an educational process. So you'll see a bunch of videos. I have one particular video on there, I think, where you were at my central farm. It's one of those unique moments that I'll probably never have, but I probably had 400 or 500 turkeys running around in an area that I just had harvested native prairie grasses. But that's been a, you know, I bought that farm in 92. So that's been a labor of love to reclaim portions of stuff that had been all fescue. And we pretty much changed that to prairie grasses and a very selective amount of what I would now still say food plot materials that help our deer and our, but I have a lot of, you know, that's the upper end of the Ozark, so I have a lot of good trees. We've done savanna improvement there. We've harvested the right kind of trees to do selective harvesting, and so when I see those things that say, hey, it's all working, you know, this stuff. You know, that's the what I call the priceless proof. I don't have to have a bunch of data from scientists.
I
see 300 or 400 turkeys in one big group running all over my hillside. That's the proof of the pudding.
Well, which brings me to, Gordon, there's so much I want to hit, but which brings me to an incredible kind of origin story, not just you as a very young person shooting rabbits with slingshots along the railroad track, but you were in St. Louis at that time, right?
Right.
Along the river. But do you mind just going back and when you were starting in the engineering and conveyance business and you're struggling with this idea of moving these cans and you drove over the Mississippi River?
Right.
Do you mind just like throwing me that story? Because it when you talk about those turkeys and all that stuff being the measure of your health, you know, of your land.
Right.
And like my, I'm successful because I can look at those incredible pollinators, all those native bees, all those monarchs down at your Prairie Lake right. here. It's like vision inspired by what's around you in nature, right?
Yeah, it really is. I mean, I have these epiphanies, and a lot of people say, and I received this award in New York this year in the industry as the visionary of the year, but I really say it's not a visionary. It's a culmination of experiences that kind of coalesce into a thought process to say, oh, I get it. And one of the things that I think, my primary business has always been the packaging. I started as a pretty young guy with a company called Container Corporation of America. I told Brandon on our little podcast that, I was a happy guy, man. I was down at my favorite swimming pool two blocks from my house working as a lifeguard, my size 28 Speedos, 44-inch chest, twirling my whistle. And my grandmother said, that's no job for a good young German boy. You need to go to work for an engineering company. So she got me this, job. And I worked in a machine shop cleaning and pushing brooms instead of working around in a swimming pool. But in that company, that turned in my career, and I worked on a project developing the Pringle potato chip can. And so I learned a lot about machinery and how machinery interacted and how when you make a product in multiple steps, each one of those steps might have what's called failures that stop it. And so as you move product along each one of those steps, if they are not allowed to accumulate between them, it stops the whole process.
Okay.
And so early on, I start thinking about, we were making cans back in the 70s and early 80s at around 600 a minute. Think about it. Today, we make aluminum beverage cans at 3,000 a minute. Now, you divide that by 60, that is phenomenal. You're looking at 50 cans a second. And the upper end of a can has a tolerance of plus or minus 2/10,000, which is less than your hair. Okay. And so we're running at these phenomenal speeds. But 35, 40 years ago, the best we could do was 600. So there was an evolution of thinking to say, okay, as each one of these cans stopped or these machines stopped, what do I do about it? How do I keep it running? So I'm driving across the JB Bridge one time, and I think, wow, why is that bluff way over there? And why is this Great Plain? And then I thought about the levees, and I said, you know what? At some point, ecological times, that river used to go all the way over there. And probably it went up and down. And when it flooded, it had this great big plain to flood out on. And I thought, well, there's transport of the water, and there's transport of my cans. Mm-hmm. What if I had accumulation? And that when the transport stopped, the cans would accumulate, but the rest of the system would just keep running, just like the river keeps running above stream and upstream.
Still going to the ocean.
Going, but it ain't flooding because it's spreading out and it's accumulating, but it's not going purely up because we've kept it in. And so I actually developed accumulation systems for my processes based on some natural systems that I saw. And I thought, there's many other accumulation systems in nature. We accumulate water in terms of ice and vapor in our oceans and our rivers and our streams, but also in the sequestration of that water into our roots and into the vegetation.
Yeah.
And if we have 300 million acres that is all in dirt in the wintertime and it's not accumulating, where do we think that's going to go? It's going to go into these rivers and streams that we've turned into transport systems, and they don't have their accumulation systems. So the same thing happens to them that happened to my can. When I didn't have those, the machines would crash, and I'd have cans flying everywhere. So the same thing's happening today. We're flooding, and the water's overtopping, and we have farmers in Missouri all stressed out again now that the levees this year are not going to hold that water coming down to Missouri.
Which is carrying a fantastic level of pollutants now.
Absolutely.
Well.
And when you look at Richard Manning's book and he gives you the history of why Teddy and, the agriculture and the great four thinkers said, hey, you know what? We want irrigation. How do we have irrigation? Well, we have to protect the headwaters. So they protected the headwaters in the mountains with forest, and they were very careful about preserving the snow so that it would run down slowly.
Yep. The origins of all our national forests were watershed protection, 1891.
Absolutely. But I don't think they ever imagined that we'd have hundreds of millions of acres right up to the edge of our rivers that would be in agriculture.
Right.
And that wouldn't allow the sedimentation and the filtration. They all had a different imagination. They couldn't imagine what happened.
Right.
And so, you know, we have to look at these same accumulation systems like I did on my processes and said, okay, the way I solved this. And so slowly I started developing wider and wider conveying systems that had more and more cans, but then bigger and bigger accumulation systems. But think about it. We went from 300 a minute to 600 a minute to 1,200 to now 3,000 a minute. Back then we used to run efficiencies where the uptime was less than 70%. Now we run uptimes of over 92% on these processes. The scrap used to be double digit, 10, 11, 12% scrap. Now we run less than 2% scrap. Every one of those 1% scrap at that speed is $1 million a year. And so what we have to think about, what kind of scrap are we creating with our floods? What kind of scrap are we creating with all this pollution that we have to deal with in our water and purification systems?
Because we're binding energy instead of letting it be itself. Right.
Yeah, exactly. But the big thing is that it's the land use. How are we using that land to help accumulate water? How are we using that land as a passive solar collector in the wintertime when we talk about global warming? You know, again, I was a physics major before, and so everything has a reaction to what you do. When you have hundreds of millions of acres that are sitting there and they're not acting as a solar collector and they're not converting to energy, that sun is heating up that dirt. Now, maybe we want that so we get 2 weeks earlier of planting, but it comes at a price. And it comes in when I drive across Kansas to go from my home here in St. Louis to my summer home sometimes that I spend a little time in Breckenridge. There's thousands and thousands of acres that are all in dirt. And the dust is blowing. And they're getting hot.
Yeah.
But what if they were all covered with grasses? They're doing transpiration and evaporation, and then slowly evaporating instead of all this quick evaporation. So we're short cycling the rain.
Right.
As soon as it rains, and a few days later, it's all evaporated instead of going back into the Ogallala.
Yeah,
it's evaporating. And
in the Ogallala aquifer, at the end of when it's done, our Great Plains go back to being the desert that John Wesley Powell said they were, because it doesn't rain.
It doesn't. I mean, yeah, maybe we have a few short years where we have an anomaly, and maybe we have 12 or 14 inches of rain, but when do we have it? Do we have it at 6 inches at a time, or do we have an inch or half an inch a week?
You know?
So that's the problem. We shouldn't take snapshots of what's happening today and say, oh, that's going to happen. We did that in the 30s, and we paid dearly for it. We're doing it again right now.
Right.
You know, this dry farming that we're doing. And so then the question is, okay, Rudy, what am I going to do with my farm? How am I going to get paid? And that's where I say, if we layer the value of the ecological societies to society and say, instead of paying all these insurance premiums, instead of paying all these farm subsidies, why not pay for ecological services? So what do I mean by that? Those lands actually sequester carbon. We're trying to get carbon out of the atmosphere, somewhere around 2 to 3 tons per acre, depending on the root system and the vegetation involved. The other thing is it's going to prevent nutrients from running into our streams and rivers, which would prevent significant cost of spending on purifying our water. What is the misery and the anguish? My daughter has flooded twice in the last 10 years in an area that was never a floodplain.
Right.
And the anguish and the problems that creates for those kids and the mold and the mildew and the filth and the dirt.
My house has been flooded twice in 2 years.
I'm going to tell you what, that turns people's lives upside down.
It is intensely rough.
So what does that cost society?
And right.
The other thing is that, you know, when we lose our pollinators, when we lose some of these, you know, people say, well, what do I care about monarch butterflies? What do I care? Well, we ought to care. Because at some point, we're at a tipping point. Those pollinators have a significant impact on everything that we grow, whether it's nut trees, whether it's fruit trees, whether it's vegetables. You know, we're moving bees all over the country now. Even in California, it's become a big industry. And, you know, even though those European bees are not natives, we have hundreds of other native bees that are being impacted by our pesticides. And so all of those have a value system, and we need to start recognizing that value system could provide an income to a farmer that doesn't force him to put that land into a type of crop that really shouldn't be there. And that's all I'm asking people to say, what's that land doing now? Is whatever you're going to do to it more valuable? And I'm not going to tell farmers what to do because I have this wonderful income from my business. And, right. and so I can't preach to them and say, hey, this is what... But I can say to society, at some point, our planet, if we strip our skin off of our body and one-third of terrestrial Earth, and our body is stripped every year, and we cake over with all these scabs, and the next year we strip it all off again, our body's going to die at some point.
Yeah,
and I mean, that's what scares me, is that that's what I see happening all over the world.
Yeah,
and this planet cannot sustain that indefinitely. It will live, but maybe not without us,
yeah.
or maybe with the
yeah.
species that you and I love to hunt and fish.
Right,
they're gonna not be able. This band that we live in, whether it's temperature, the amount of oxygen that we have, the whole atmosphere that we have, this amazing force field. You know, we talk about some of the science fiction. We have this amazing force field that protects us, a magnetic. The oxygen and the atmosphere, at some point, will it blow away?
Yeah.
So I just think we can't take all these environmental services that we have that are provided by our grasslands. And I say grasslands because in a matter of 5 to 10 years, we could regrow grassland. Mm-hmm. And you saw the significant grassland that I've been able to replant.
It's unbelievable.
Deep roots.
Yeah.
We can't do that with trees. We're
yeah.
talking about planting a trillion trees.
Right.
In my lifetime, I'm never going to see the results and the benefit of all those trees.
Right.
The Chinese have
also,
done.
Also, that's a very simplistic idea. Like I grew up with Weyerhaeuser and working as a tree planter, planting those second, we called them second gen loblolly.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that was a ecological desert that we were creating
right.
there
right.
in order to get a 25-year rotation on pulp. And now, like on public land in the South, we're putting back the longleaf and the diverse hardwoods and all that stuff, paying for that.
Right.
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 I mean, it was a bad idea
yeah,
at the time.
And I'm glad you bring that up, Alec, because what I've done here is before I planted, I spent a lot of time talking to different departments and say, hey, what do deer want? What do quail want? What do our grassland birds need? So when I planted here, I put a diversity of 25 different species of forbs and legumes, 6 different species of grasses, 2 cool season, 4 warm season grasses. I wish I had the resources and the seed source to do 400 species because that's what our grassland used to be.
Yeah.
But I didn't. And I didn't have the access. And even if I had the money, I wouldn't have the access to plant. But there is, we've studied again with the University of Minnesota, and there is a 16 to 25 to 30 species that it's never going to ever recreate a real prairie.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to be a facsimile that's a lot better than just a pure monolithic switchgrass or fescue.
Right.
Or especially fescue that is a non-native species that doesn't support the microbial community that I keep talking about below the soil.
Yeah.
So I think we can make a facsimile that I've seen here that the birds are attracted. I have quail that most of my neighbors are amazed that are back. I mean,
yeah.
We have turkeys. This is a concentration of turkeys. The Department of Conservation actually came to me a number of years ago and said, hey, you've got the highest concentration of turkeys. We'd like to trap some of your birds. So I went through a 2-year process to understand what's it going to do to my bird population because I've worked really hard to bring them back and I didn't want them to have a negative impact. But I see the results from the wildlife standpoint. I see the results in my lakes and
yeah.
how clear my lakes
yeah,
are.
And
the
that
fish
creek.
That I have. The creek that we drove through
yeah.
that in the northern Missouri where you have a high rate of erosion that was crystal clear like an Ozark stream.
Yeah.
So I don't need a scientist to show me
right.
that. But
I didn't have anything to compare it to, but for the dead of, we're at the very turn of winter, right? Very end of February.
Mm-hmm.
But there, I saw so many birds, most of which I could identify from my growing up days, you know,
mm-hmm.
but red birds and the kingfisher on the creek and, mm-hmm. and the bald eagles probably working in front of that burn.
Right.
You know, but just the diversity of bird life you've got here is extraordinary.
Well, I think what you'd really find gratifying, you know, there's some birds of concern like bobolinks. We have other grassland birds that are here in prolific numbers once it starts to warm up. And again, we're doing some work with Iowa State where they actually have monitors and they're monitoring birds. And then young students actually listen to these recordings so that we can, at various types of landscape, look at, you know, how is this impacting the birds? They're actually going out with butterfly nets and they're catching various insects to see how is on various strata of land that I have. So there's a lot of science going into it because the last thing I want to do is advocate and preach what I'm doing and then find out 10 years I was totally wrong. that would be devastating to me to have said, hey, I've tried to start a movement and I'm dead wrong, because there's too much of that that's happened over time. And the last thing I want is the farmers to follow me and find out they're dead wrong. And then, you know, I affect their livelihoods. So I have been very careful. I've been spending my own money on this research. But I see the results from an animal perspective, which is my original selfish motivation.
Sure.
I still don't let, even though I probably have a good dozen coveys of quail, I don't let anybody hunt my quail, even though the department says, hey, you know, it's not going to have much of an impact. But I don't want a human impact at this point to kind of slow down, because 2 years ago we had a terrible winter. I mean, it was awful here. Had ice and snow. We still had snow on the ground in the middle of the March, and I thought my quail were not going to make it, but yet they made it. Mm-hmm. And so if the right habitat is there, even with the predators, and people say, well, we got too many, you know, we got too many predators, nobody traps anymore. But I think if the habitat is right, all those predators used to be there.
Right.
And somehow quail used to make it.
Yeah.
And so I think if the habitat is right, if you give them an opportunity and you have the right, you know, conditions long enough, they're going to survive. And I see that here on my farm where I do have quail. And, you know, nothing is more enjoyable on a spring day listening to or seeing a male quail sitting on a hay bale and singing and calling to them.
And it's something we've lost. Like, it's something that I grew up with until about age 12. And then it disappeared.
Yeah.
And it's amazing the things that you don't really get used to. The loss is there still, right? Like, when you hear it again, you remember.
Yeah. Well, one of my anxieties every year I go through in spring at my farm you visit in Central Missouri, I have a bunch of purple martin houses, and I always say, hey, are they going to make it back? The other thing I see going away at my central, which is the Ozarks, and I'm sure Brandon would appreciate, is the whippoorwills.
Yeah.
You know, we all grew up, if we lived in the forest, and
absolutely,
I'm sure you did, we loved
it. Oh, boy.
It. No, you loved and hated them, because sometimes they kept you up all night. But you know, my mom used to live in, I had this old stone home that used to be next to that, and there was a big porch there, and I think that it was warm. So right by that bedroom, those whippoorwills would come and they'd sing right next to my mom. And I was sleeping downstairs, all of a sudden I'd hear, shh, shh,
stop it.
Shut up, you stupid bird. But now I long for those birds, and I think, oh, gee, is that another thing that's vanishing? You know, we're losing those. And
I remember that as the soundtrack, big cicadas, you know, wah, 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 and then those, and then the whippoorwills starting up at a certain time.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think, you know, those things, unfortunately, a lot of the kids nowadays, when you talk about a whippoorwill, they don't even know what you're talking about.
Right.
And a lot of things that we're losing because kids are living up with these computers and iPads and in the city. And that connectivity, I think, has part of the stress that I see with society today, where you hear these terrible things. There's not that connectivity that I had, that when I was really stressed, I'd come to my farm and I'd spend a weekend and maybe just sit on a stump for a little while and or see a little squirrel come run up to me, or even sitting in a tree stand sometime, you know, have a squirrel and almost come up to your shoulder.
Sure.
I don't know how to describe that recharge to my soul, but it did.
Yeah.
And when we lose these species, how do you put a value to that? You know, and that's what I worry about. I my vision into China is, when I talk to those young people there, they have no clue what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And because, you know, the population has driven it to the point where it's so dense, and you have all these high rises and all this concrete. The Chinese probably put more concrete down on their country in the last 20 years than we did in 100 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I see, you know, India and all. When you go to Indonesia, you go to all these countries and the populations. When I immigrated here, there was 135, 140 million people. Now we're over 300 million people since 1956.
Right.
So what's going to happen when there's a billion people here?
Yeah.
And so I think we need to start looking at our land as an asset, and what's the best use of that asset. And a society willing to say, yeah, you know, clean air and clean water is not free. And we've taken it for granted, and it isn't something that we should consider free, when in Missouri, 95% of the landscape is owned by private property, and it has an impact on those things.
Right.
And so, you know, we have to look at our subsidy systems. I think we have to look at the value system that we have for land, and how do we get to a point where we have some equilibrium and we're not going to continue to destroy our landscape.
Hey, everybody, this is Hal Herring, Backcountry Hunters and Anglers Podcast and Blast. This is some troubled times across the United States and across the world. And my heart goes out to all those folks who are sick or suffering or worried about their loved ones. And also, it's a tough time to be what it's sheltering up and with all that beautiful spring weather out there and all this fishing and turkey hunting and spring bear and all this wandering it needs doing out there. But hey, we'll get there. I'm sure of that. In the meantime, I'd like to let everybody know this is a great time to become a member of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers and jump in here and help us pull this thing forward and have some fun doing it. If you join now, they've got a free T-shirt that it's a $25 value, they tell me, and the membership's $35. So you basically get a T-shirt and a membership for $10. You can join in with some like-minded folks. And also, you got a subscription to Backcountry Journal, which is fast becoming, if not already, the finest outdoor magazine in the United States. It's got some great writing, some great photos. So jump in if you can. Go to backcountryhunters.org/BHA podcast. So that's backcountryhunters.org/BHA podcast. That'll get you to the membership and the t-shirt and some other perks of being a member of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers. So jump in if you can. Stay safe, stay strong, stay optimistic. And hey, I'll see you out there. Thanks again, everybody. We passed on through it, but the renewable natural gas thing is it kind of a cornerstone of the profit making part of this eventually?
It is today. It's primarily because of the California market. You know, the Californians are sometimes considered to be pretty extreme about environmental issues, but they are.
Well, they got more people in a smaller space.
Well, but not only that, you know, they're almost a country in itself. They're in the top 10 of economic might in the whole world, not just the United States. I mean, they're a huge entity in some population and EDP. And so when you look at their gross domestic product and what they produce, you know, they have the ability, they have a huge amount of oil refineries there. They have a lot of agriculture. They supply a tremendous amount of food. And they are extremely progressive and I think, you know, sometimes environmentally extreme.
Yeah.
But I remember going as a young boy, my mother and father settled in St. Louis. The rest of our family from Europe settled in L.A. area. And the first two or three years that I went there, I didn't realize they had mountains. I never saw them.
Gotcha.
And so in the summertime, it would be so smoggy and so foggy in the morning. Sometimes you wouldn't see the sun until noon. And so that valley they have there and many of the valleys they have would settle in. And, you know, it hasn't gotten much better unless they would have did what they did. So now they're trying to eliminate, you know, almost all of the diesel coming through their cities. And they're looking at the health of their people. What does that health value, how much does that cost in health costs
right.
when you have all these illnesses that are related to the smog and the pollution that you have?
Right.
And so I think
that doesn't even come in, like if you had something like the coronavirus show up and now you have all these people respiratory compromised already.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think, you know, getting back to what we were focusing on is that there are other states, New York, and there's Oregon, there's Washington, there's other states now looking at this low carbon fuel standard and saying, can we initiate things to move towards a carbon neutral society? You know, I listen to a lot of the debates, and although I hear our politicians saying, hey, we're going to be carbon neutral by 2050, 2040, or 2030, I wonder how many of them actually realize the pathway it's going to take to get there.
Right. You know,
sometimes I hear them vilifying even natural gas. You know, I heard Amy Klobuchek say, well, natural gas needs to be a bridge and a pathway, and she's dead right, because we're not going to eliminate all these things. And I tell people if they want to know the impact of doing that,
yeah.
What we need to do is twice a year, on January 25th, which is my wife's birthday, and on July 25th, which is my birthday, probably the two of the coldest and warmest days of the year, we just need to turn off all fossil fuels for
okay.
a day
yeah.
and see what kind of impact that has to our society. Can we get there? I think we can, but it has to be a multi-phased approach. It's not going to all be through photovoltaics and solar. It's not going to be all through wind. It's going to be a combination of a lot of distributive energy. I happen to be an electrical engineer. I know the inefficiencies of electricity.
Yeah.
For every BTU you put into a generator, only 40% of that turns into electricity. you have transmission losses. When you increase the voltage and decrease the voltage, you have losses. And so not all the BTUs are turned directly into. And then the other issue is what does that do to the landscape? What's the, you know, what's really the cost of the landscape of moving all of this electricity all over the country? The other side of it is that, you know, we need to get smarter about and have a more sophisticated integrated grid that uses energy where it's actually produced. For me to get credit right now, I'm putting my gas into a pipeline, but the only way I have a market value for it is that molecule is taken out into California.
Mm-hmm. Where it can be traded.
Where it can be traded.
Yeah.
And so there is a movement. Yeah. I see it happening. You know, Brandon visited New York and talked to their assembly, and we see a movement, and I think that movement is going to continue. But it takes an initiative. It takes some leadership to say, this is not going to cost our society money. It's going to create all these new jobs that I'm talking about that my young people are so excited. It's going to take a new look at land and how we use land and can we use it in a more effective way.
What's the role of government in this?
Well, I think government are not going to be the technocrats or the scientists that figure it out. But I think government has to play a role in terms of the size and scale that we have to do this. We can't do it on these little incremental, you know, one state does. And I think we have to get to a point of a policy where we look at it and say, this really makes sense for our country. And is our country going to wait for Germany and Italy and all these other smaller countries when we have the, you know, the economic might of all of them put together? Are we going to take a leadership role? There's been a hesitancy, I think, by this administration, because I think they believe that it puts an undue disadvantage on our country to try to achieve these without the other countries also contributing, like China and these others. But I see Germany doing things. I see other countries that are ahead of us in terms of both technology and effort to get there. There's many parts of Europe that have already taken your initiatives 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And so I don't think we need to wait back. You know, in the short time I've been doing it, we've developed some wonderful technology. It's certainly not the panacea, but we've made some advancements in technology. But I've done it with my own money. If we were to get behind this with the Department of Energy, the Department of Ag, and, you know, the various resources that we have, and not work in a silo, work together to say all of these affect each other. They don't.
It's ecology. I mean, that seems to be one of the things that we've lost on every level of government and in our understanding sometime amongst amongst people, is that everything is ecological. It's all connected. And I'm not going all woo-woo, it's all one.
Yeah.
It's like, but everything you pull, like I spoke with Frank Oberle and you last night at the Wild Turkey Federation banquet, you know, and they were talking about, like, there can be uses of government that disincentivizes people to do the right thing. You can have crop insurance for plowing and busting the worst land on earth. You can literally use the force of government for good or ill. And it's a terrible thing when you have an entity, a powerful entity that's supposed to be bringing us forward, which is actually canning us back.
Yeah, I think there's always, you know, some unintended consequences, especially when people want to take advantage of programs and not necessarily use them the way they were intended.
Yeah.
I don't say that we did any of this with the wrong intentions.
I think it was well-intentioned.
But I think we need to review them on an annualized basis and not let them be continuous paradigms that, you know, other people get wealthy off, whether it's insurance programs or, you know, whether it's subsidy programs. They need to be reviewed and say, in this time and in this space, are they still applicable to where we want to go with society and how we want to support? And who do we want to support?
Right.
You know, I haven't asked for any financial support because I really don't think that at the scale that I want to do it, to prove what I want to do, I shouldn't be asking for it. So I haven't.
Gotcha.
So if I fail, you know, it's like the CoBank's been wanting to loan me this money for over 3 years. And I said, listen, I believe in what Will Rogers said. I'm not so much concerned about the return on the money as I am of the money. I want to be able to return the money. When I'm convinced that I can do that, I'll borrow the money. And so when we got to that point, I did. And so now I think where we're at is we have proven that what we're doing works and can be scaled up across the country to all these dairy farms, to all these different things, and allow that dairy farmer and these pig farmers to make a little bit more money on the gas. But what I also like to convince them is that by looking at their land very critically and taking 10 to 15% out of that land and putting it in the prairie and planting cover crops, they can have an additional source of revenue from the gas. But if we give them a revenue that also recognizes they would purify our water, they would prevent flooding, they would provide wildlife habitat. You know, what's that worth to Johnny Morrison if he doesn't have any clean water to put his boats in?
Right.
Or we can't fish except for brown trout that I don't want to call them brown turds. But, but I mean, you know, that's what I literally see. You've been to Brazil. Yep. I've been to Brazil. I've been to developing countries. There are rivers and streams that they don't support fish anymore.
You can't believe how bad they are.
You can't drink the water.
Right.
I mean, to purify the water, and even after it's purified, I'd be hesitant to let my kids want to drink it.
Yeah. So. And it's that thing, I don't know who wrote this. It was supposed to be a Native American quote, but it's the end of living and the beginning of survival. When you lose all these things that we're talking about, you know, and it's just, we haven't had to face that as Americans yet.
No.
But it's faced every day all over the world.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And why would we choose that?
I've seen developing nations in Africa. I've done work in Lagos. I've been to South Africa. I've been fortunate enough to get to hunt in some places. And the first thing I always travel to is, you know, what's the wildlife? And usually where there is no hunting, mm-hmm. there is no wildlife.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what came first, mm-hmm. but I have to believe that when the value system for our wildlife goes away, then they get extirpated and they get either eaten or nobody cares about them. But where you establish a real value system, and it gets back, it doesn't matter how valuable they are. If they don't have a habitat, they can't survive.
Right.
And so, you know, even in African countries now, they're preserving habitat because they recognize the value of wildlife. And that wildlife sustains economically some of the tribes and some of the people surrounding it. And so once those people recognize that they support it and it helps, you know, kind of suppress the poaching. There's always going to be a segment that takes advantage.
Sure. Well, people are very mobile. I've got friends in Zambia, you know, and some of their major poaching comes from nations and nations away.
Right. And that all gets back to these market-based solutions. You know, a lot of that is driven by the Chinese market, who still believe that a lot of these animals have aphrodisiac effects, they have health effects. And now we've seen, I think, the coronavirus is an example of, you know, a country that doesn't value biosecurity as much as our own country. We have a tremendous amount of biosecurity on our animal production, our food production. I've walked through marketplaces. You know, I took my daughter... over 20 years ago, I took one of my daughters to China, and we walked into this place, and they had all sorts of caged animals. And my daughter looked at me, and she goes, "Is this a pet shop?" And the young interpreter told her, "Oh no," she says, "we sell these animals." And she goes, "What for?" She says, "Oh, we eat them." Oh, and my daughter started crying. Said, "Dad, please, you got to buy these animals and let them go." And I said, "Well, honey, if I let them go, they're never going to make it across the street."
Right.
So, I think we see a different culture, and as I said earlier, people are not going to stop these cultures of eating food and protein and things.
Right.
But we have to work towards, you know, is that how do we slowly change the mentality? And I think this coronavirus is going to open up. It's going to open up some recrimination against China to say, hey, listen, you know, this doesn't just affect you. And that's what we talked about. Where does the punch stop? Does it stop at my nose or after you break my nose?
Right.
And I think they're breaking our nose in the whole country with this coronavirus as a result of their biosecurity.
Yeah.
And, you know,
or lack thereof.
And it is a deep cultural belief that there are certain things that they can eat that, you know, makes them healthier, that cure certain ills. And I'm not saying all that is, you know, is wrong.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. But I do see the other side of it. And I see that, you know, we have health requirements here that are much more stringent.
Yeah.
And I think would impede some of these things. So I don't know where this coronavirus is going to go. You know, they had the African swine fever on their hogs. They've got a avian flu issue, and all of them stems from a different set of paradigms and standards for food safety and what I would call biosecurity, and how we make sure that we don't pass on these pathogens to these various animals or to ourselves and have it cross over.
Right. So what I don't want to burn you out. I know we're going long on this, and I just to me, this was when I met you through Brandon Butler down there at Conservation Federation of Missouri, and immediately listening to the 2-hour talk we had, I just saw this as the vision. It's a vision. right, for a way forward. And I could go on and on with this, but I've just been involved in agriculture and pollution and runoff and losses and investigating this stuff for 20 years, you know. And I saw here the first time, and I wasn't anywhere near grasping this at first, right? But I saw for the first time somebody addressing it as an ecological whole, you know. And that, and your idea of the 30 million acres of prairie restoration, looking at your creeks buffered with that native prairie, it's just like, I see a future that we would all want to live in.
Yeah, I think it is, you know, certainly a microcosm of what could be expanded on a scale that would make an impact.
Gotcha.
And I really believe that, you know, we need to, as a society, start collaborating more and litigating less.
Yep.
And unfortunately, sometimes it takes litigation for you to get to the pain where you will collaborate. And I've seen that, you know, in many instances, and in my own case in business, sometimes it takes that because you have these huge disagreements and you can't come to the table. But I think Brandon pointed it out earlier. You have a company like Smithfield Food collaborating with EDF. You have myself and the Nature Conservancy. As I'm an industrialist, I've built facilities all, but I contribute a significant amount of my resources to organizations like the Nature Conservancy, the Missouri yeah. Prairie Foundation, and other. I'm a life member of almost every, you know, the organization we went to last night, the National Wild Turkey Federation,
right.
Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation, you know, Quail and Pheasants Forever. And
yeah.
I believe in all those organizations. And we have established a collaborative effort on my farm. I use their knowledge and their resources to help me make sound scientific decisions. Because what really started me is I would come home from China. And I mean, I would just be absolutely frantic. And I'm a guy that can't come home and just sit on his ass. I'd had to go out and say, I got to do something. So I'd go dig up and I'd do a bunch of stuff and I'd make things. And then I'd say, could you really make it better? And I'd ask myself, why did you pick those trees to eliminate? Why did you pick this? And I'd ask, did you make it better? What does better really mean? And so then I went to the Department of Conservation and I started helping define what better meant. You know,
yeah.
And I'd give them my goals and objectives. I say, I want healthier deer. I want bigger deer, not necessarily more. But what can I do? Some of my deer are kind of puny compared to up north. And,
yeah.
And so they educated me about that, you know, and they educated me about what kind of grasses and forbs. And then, you know, I actually initiated a call to the Midwestern Conservation Biomass Alliance, which was a bunch of universities. And I asked them to study the attributes of different plants and, you know, carbon sequestration, amount of biomass they would produce, how they would support pollinators. And so my 25 species I selected on the basis of that.
Wow.
And so it's been this long journey of education. And at 72, you know, my motto at my business and my life is be humble, be hungry, and stay happy. Well, I can't help it. I can't help be humble because of where I came from. And I look at guys on the street corner and always think, you know, Patsy for handing out $100 bills, because I always think that could be me. Mm. You know, I've been through two near-death experiences with my mm-hmm. company, and you can always go back. And so I'm very humble about my background and my beginning. My dad taught me to always be hungry, and I don't mean about another hamburger. I'm talking about hungry for knowledge, hungry for improving yourself, hungry for never being satisfied with what things are today. So I'm not satisfied with where we are. If there's people think that what we're doing in the United States is satisfying to the whole, you know, population, they're dead wrong.
Yeah.
And the last one is, you know, I'm extremely happy that, like I said this morning, I got a lot of serious back aches and back, but I'm happy to wake up, talk to you today, make a difference, and
yeah.
hopefully our conversation today can get people to think about, you know,
yeah.
is what we're doing today really the solution?
Right.
Or are there other ways to use our land that contributes not just to that farmer for that time and what he's doing having such a huge impact on the rest of society?
Right.
So is the rest of society going to just condemn him? Or are they going to say, no, I'm going to help you do something different?
Right. And what you're talking about with multi-layered markets for each farm, so you can sort of name commodity prices too. They're not completely out of your control in this
right.
giant exploded
right.
balloon
right.
out in the global marketplace.
Yeah.
But you're on something here. That about the jobs, like I was watching the burning crew today, you know, and people, how excited they are about restoring landscapes and what they're doing. And one of the big things, if people listen to this podcast, I probably bang on this too much, but is I've lived in rural America my whole life, you know, and I see a real value in that culture and that knowledge. And I've watched that decline, and I've watched that be abandoned sort of by government and all my life. And I just, part of it, it's really valuable to me personally, and I think I'm not wrong. You know, and one of the things you're showing here, you're making this model here of where there is employment, there are more jobs, because mechanized agriculture got rid of jobs like a dog shedding winter hair, right?
Right, right.
And if we're going to make this work and have people understand how things work, there are going to have to be people out in the country.
Absolutely. And you know what motivated me, and I think I shared this with Brandon in my earlier iPod. Podcast with him, was that being as humble as I was and as poor as I was, I used to hunt along the Salt River, and there was a back road that kind of went up to a bridge, and the bridge was out, and I hunted there and probably till I was about 18 or 19 without asking permission, because nobody ever went there. And I thought, well, gee, you know, who's going to bother me? But then I got that at age where I thought, that's not right. It's somebody's property. So I searched around, and I found out who owned the farm, and it was just a family by the name of Forsyth. And Judy and I only had one car at the time, so if I took the car, she didn't have a vehicle. And so usually I would just go up for a weekend and come back, and I'd sleep in the back of that car. And one night it was super, super cold, and I happened to visit that family and asked them permission. They said, well, where are you staying? I said, well, I'm sleeping over there in that bridge. So, well, why aren't you staying in town? I said, well, I really can't afford the hotels. And it was getting on towards dinner, and she said, well, why don't you come in for dinner? So we went in for dinner and had one of the best chicken dinners I ever had. And she said, where are you going tonight? I said, I'll go back. No, you're not. You're going to stay here. So they asked me and begged. Literally, I felt really imposing on them and didn't feel right. They said, no, you know, our son Phil, he's gone, and we'd love to have another young man in the house. Why don't you stay with us? They didn't know me from Adam.
Right.
Here I am. I'm sleeping in their bedroom and eating their food. Got to be super close friends with them. And I think that kind of generosity that is in rural America still exists.
Yeah.
And when I see the town squares in Missouri and Iowa and a lot of them, and half of the stores are taped up or they got white paint on and they're empty, it pains me.
Yeah.
So if people think all this rural agriculture is working for that farmer, it's not. And so we have to, if we want to infuse life, we have to infuse technology. We have to infuse jobs that these kids are willing to pursue. These young guys that I have working on these gas purification systems, I can't tell you how excited they are. The amount of excitement I see in them, and I saw it in Germany. I asked these farmers, because I speak fluent German, I said, why are you building these million-dollar facilities? And you're paying for them? They go, yeah, you know, I'm doing it because I want my kids to have a different lifestyle. I don't want them getting up before sundown and sundown and always worrying about how they're going to pay the next bill, because they always think next year is going to be better.
Yeah, like here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so when I see the erosion, when I see how hard my neighbor Chad and his wife Tanya work to raise those kids, you know, I'm hoping in this little area I can show an example of something that complements and maybe provides another solution to what we're doing.
Gotcha.
And as I said, I'm not going to say that's the panacea, but it could be, as replicated on a large scale, make a significant difference. I mean, our calculations are that if we were to do what I did with 100 and propose for 100 million acres and 30 million acres and the manure, we could energize $56 billion into the agricultural industry that isn't there today. If you look at the decline of income over the last 5 years, it is significant.
Will you say that again?
Yeah, we could interject $56 billion into the agricultural industry from just producing methane alone. I'm not even talking about the other services of carbon credits, of water and soil erosion and nutrient recovery, and what we would do to flooding. That could be hundreds of billions of dollars. And that's not something that I think any administration should just say, hey, gee, this is going to cost us money.
Is there,
it's like everything else. Is there an investment? I risked $57 million of my own money because I did an employee stock ownership program. I sold my stock, and instead of going out to your beloved Montana or Wyoming and buying a ranch, I decided I can't sit on the sidelines. So I reinvested it. I took the risk. I showed society that we can do this. I showed Smithfield. And now, you know, we're going to have $160, $170 million invested up here because it's going to work. It's not
going to
work. And so I think
lest anybody think that was without pain, I won't tell them the whole story, but the tornadoes blew away all the stuff.
And
y'all suffered the growing pains that you might expect and then weathered them, right?
Yeah, this year is the first year that we're actually showing a profit. I mean, it took 7 or 8 years of no profit, 2 years of extreme anxiety. One of them is, you know, we had a PERS virus up here in 2016. So the year that I thought we were actually going to make a little bit of money, we didn't. And I had to appeal to Smithfield to help me get, you know, the right amount of pigs in the barn, and they responded. And the next year when we thought we were actually going to get some money was when it really shook my faith, because we had a really bad storm, and they didn't define it as a tornado, but it destroyed half the barns, it ripped off the lagoons.
You called it.
You know, there was no income that year again, and so, you know, I drove home that day, like I said, thinking, gee, you got millions of acres up here, Lord, why this particular farm? What are you trying to tell me, that I'm doing the devil's work instead of your work? And I spent some nights on my knees that day really praying as to what I was doing, and I was completely off base. But like everything in life, I've never quit, you know, whether it's in sports or I still, at 70 years old, I challenged myself to climb a couple 14ers in Breckenridge for my birthday.
Yeah.
Finished a little sprint triathlon at 71 last year. And
cool.
Challenged myself physically and mentally. So that was just another one of those bumps in the road that I absorbed and carried on. And,
yeah.
You know, fortunately today, that mentality of being stubborn, not quitting, I see the light. We actually are going to make a little money this year. Next year is even looking better. And I have the support of Smithfield. Now we have loans, so I don't have to carry the whole financial load. So I'm very excited about but mostly I'm excited about what I see, the enthusiasm from the young people. I think those guys have walked through fires for me now.
Yeah.
And they literally are out here.
Yeah, we saw it. Yeah. Well, before we close up, I know you've got for people who are listening to this or that are like the hunting and fishing hardcores of America, you know, you've done an awful lot of elk hunting around the West. I know you've hunted Africa and stuff, but in North America, you were telling me y'all got in big trouble in the Yukon in storms hunting moose. But Brandon had asked me to ask you about the White Mountains on elk hunting.
Oh God. You know, I've developed some really good friends relationships with the Apaches there. And years ago, I hunted the Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation, and David Allen and I happened to be in the same camp, and a camp called Torsten in New Mexico, and they had that ranch bequeathed to them. And again, I think David Allen took a liking to me, because it was one of those hunts. So it was a late December hunt that I booked kind of late, and I had still yet to kill a really nice. I killed kind of I would say a raghorn in New Mexico years ago, but I'd never killed a great elk. So I hunted, and it was one of those typical stories. Oh, you should have been here last year. You know, this year's a drought. The animals aren't quite as big. But I ended up toughing it out. And we had below 0 degree weather in December, 2 or 3 feet of snow, and I was muzzleloader hunting. And we're a couple of my, I'm not going to mention who else was there, but a couple of my campmates decided not to go. And I kept going out, and the 15 minutes of light left on the last night, I killed a really nice 5x5 with my muzzleloader from about 185 yards. And so that night we were having a few adult beverages, and we got to talking about the White Mountains. And David Allen said, hey, do you like to go there? I said, well, which one of my grandkids do you want? And so he actually invited me. He invited me to the next show in Vegas that year, and this was, I think it was 2011. Yeah, it must have been 2011. And so he invited me, and I took a friend of mine and our wife, and we got there, and I visited the show, and I saw the booth from the White Mountains, and I walked up to a couple of Apaches there and said, "Hey, you guys have any openings?" They said, "Yeah, we did have, but I think the tag's spoken for." I thought, oh, crap. And so I went to dinner that night, and David came up to me and my wife and my friends, and he looked at Judy and said, hey, he says, I understand your husband's going to go to the White Mountains this year. My eyes got about that big, and he said, yeah, go see John Caden, you know, and they did. They had a tag for me, and so I've been going there every year since. I mean, it's an amazing place. It's probably expensive for most people, but again, fortunately, I'm in a position where at this stage of my life, I've spent some time hunting elk in other states, in both New Mexico and I used to hunt in southern Wyoming back when it was allowed for us Nimrods from the Midwest to actually go into some of the areas that they now keep us out of.
A matter of great controversy at the moment, by the way.
And so, it's one of those areas that we felt like, well, if we get lost, that's our problem. And we had some great times bow hunting in now designated wilderness areas. But back then I was a triathlete and hiking 10, 12 miles a day was nothing.
Yeah.
But I've had a great fortune of hunting the White Mountains, and I have to tell you, it's you die and go to heaven. I see 20 or 30 big bulls. I've killed a 400-inch bull. I've killed a 390.
That's the Harley bull.
Want me to tell you about the Harley?
Yeah, really? Yeah. I definitely do.
Yeah, so I have to be a little bit ashamed about this, I guess, but, I tend to find out what motivates people in life, and I found out that my guide was a Harley nut, and I had this Harley that my board of directors and my wife said I can't ride anymore, and so I kind of put it to this guy. I said, listen, if you can find me a 400-inch bull and you put me on him, even if I screw up, I said, that's yours. Mm-hmm. So for about 3 or 4 years, everybody's looking for the Harley bull. So the year... I guess it was 4 years ago. We come up on this bull, and this bull was a really nice, probably a 370. And he walked within 15 yards, and I didn't shoot him. And the young bird dog, the assistant guide, he was so livid and so pissed off at me. He wouldn't talk to me for 3 days. Well, a couple of days later, I killed a 390, but it wasn't a Harley bull. And so the kid asked me, he said, why didn't you shoot that other bull? I said, I set my goal. I told your guy that, I didn't care at this point because I'd killed some nice bulls. I didn't want to kill them. So the strange thing is, the next year, that same young guy that was all upset, he found that same bull, and now he was a Harley bull. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was over 400 inches. And believe it or not, these guys, by the tone of that bull, went out the next night, and we found that bull. And my grandson saw me take that bull, and it was one of the highlights of my life to be with my grandson and watch me. And it was a pretty good long shot through a small opening, and bull just ran about 40 yards and dropped. And so it was probably one of the highlights of my hunting career to have my young grandson with me and watch me take that bull. He had taken, at 14 years old, he took a 5x5 management bull just a couple nights before.
Yeah.
So having that experience, and then the next year, of course, those guys that I hunt with, some of them are pretty well-heeled guys, and they were all thinking, yeah, sure, sure. So I pulled up the following year with the Harley, fat boy, beautiful fat boy on the back of my trailer. And I'm looking up as I pull in, and them guys are all standing there just kind of scowling at me. So we go to dinner that night, and they're all still kind of scowling. And I'm going, all right, what the hell's up? All right, Rudy. What are we supposed to do for a tip now? I said, well, I guess you better start visiting the Harley dealers.
Yeah. We're going to set the bar high.
Yeah. So it was kind of, it's kind of the story, because the same group of guys, we lost a guy that was kind of, I guess, one of the guys that had been coming there for about 10 years. He passed away. He actually asked that his ashes be spread there, and I've made some similar requests in a place they call Rudy's Point that is just absolutely beautiful, and all the guys have come to know me, and I guess I've endeared myself to them. I usually don't kill anything till 9th or 10th day, because I'm there to hunt, not just to kill something. And so I've had a great experience. The place reminds me of Yellowstone a lot. It's a lot of volcanic remnants there.
Yeah.
And the streams and rivers are absolutely beautiful. They manage their herd really well. And the guy, John Cade, that actually started that program, I mean, he did an outstanding program. He's since moved on. I think there was, time for him to spread his wings and move on. And the tribe has kind of taken over that. But, part of what I see there, and I hope this doesn't come across the wrong way, I still see a little bit of a political influence from the tribal leaders on to the biologists. And one of the things that, I get concerned about is our state is one of the few states that are not controlled by the legislature.
Your state being Missouri.
Yeah, not controlled by politics.
And yeah.
It's a constant fight where the legislature really wants to control. And, we have a group of biologists and scientists that dedicated themselves, and they wear that little triangle of the Missouri Department of Conservation very, very proudly. And I'm hoping our state, is wise enough that, hey, this has worked really well for over 70 years.
Yeah.
And we don't try to fix the whole thing. If there are things that our legislature or people don't like, let's look at what we don't like. Let's not throw out the baby with the dirty wash, and let's look at what we don't like and fix it.
Yeah.
But I think, the results I've seen, we've brought back deer, we brought back turkey, we've taken turkey from Missouri and taken them all over the country. We have one of the best turkey populations still in the top three in the country.
Yeah.
And we've done so many great things, so we shouldn't get to the point where if we have a few issues we're not happy with.
Right. And there was a actually ballot initiative. It was a divorce to take the Missouri Department of Conservation out from under the legislature 70, 80 years ago, right?
Yeah, it was, I think, 1937 I think, when that happened. And each year, we have an 1/8 of 1% sales tax that our citizens over and over again want specifically dedicated to conservation. And I'm not just talking about consumptive use. I'm talking about lakes and streams and rivers and many things that our department does that I think, I hear people all over the world when I hunt. Like I said, I've hunted in Africa. I've hunted a lot of places. People know about our department and what we do and that model. So I think it's a good model. But, like I said earlier, if we look at agriculture, everything needs a review.
Yeah.
And the stuff that isn't relevant anymore, you look at it and say, how do we improve it?
Yeah. And then stuff like this, it becomes with painfully obvious. I got from having me reported in other states that do work. And you say, yes, we'll look at it every time, but we're not going to throw that baby out with that bathwater.
Right, right.
Yeah.
So I think going back again to my business experience, I have what's called the lessons learned. Every project that we finish with a customer, as painful as it is, we sit down with that customer and say, what did we do well? What can we improve on? What should you be doing versus what should I be doing? And we have these lessons learned, and I'm never satisfied that the progression is finished. And that gets back to that hunger factor that I talk about, that the hunger and the yearning to constantly improve and not just say, hey, we've made it.
Right.
And I think this country needs to be that way. We can't be a society that says, oh, we've made it. Well, some people have made it, but we've left a lot of people behind.
Right.
And so how do we bring those people up to a par where they believe, okay, yeah, I've made it, but I want to keep improving.
Right.
And so I think, whether it's agriculture or Department of Conservation or whether it's business, people need to take the lessons learned, and we do that, with these new processes that we've developed. I didn't get from 600 a minute to 3,000 a minute by being satisfied. Oh, I made it from 600 to 1,200.
Right.
It was never good enough. And, even at 3,000 a minute, we reduced the amount of material. The amount of material that we use today in a can is less than 50% of what we used 30 years ago.
Yeah.
So we need to look at landscape and say, can we reduce, 50% more food? Can we be more efficient? Can we be less efficient with waste? How do we use that land to provide the services that society needs so it isn't all about, okay, that landowner's getting money, but he's getting it because of subsidies or he's getting it because of, an artificial price. But the honest truth is at $3 a bushel and at $7 or $8 a bushel for beans, it's pretty hard because, I don't consider myself a farmer.
Yeah.
But I'm a pretty shrewd businessman, and I can run the models pretty quickly on what the input costs are, what my equipment costs are, my labor costs. And as hard as we've tried, there's been only one year that we've made money on this particular farm in 10 years and what we do, and it's the year that we got an insurance payment. And that's broken.
Wow.
That's not right.
That is incredible.
That's not. And, we don't do 200 or 300 bushels an acre like they do in Iowa. So,
But you are in a community of people who farm their butts off to try to make
do the
that,
same thing.
Yeah,
and that's
yeah,
my
you
point.
Bet.
That's my point. I mean, a lot of this land here that's hill country is going to do 135 to 165 bushels of corn and maybe, 35 to 50 bushels of bean. And then your input costs are, around $500. So it just doesn't work.
So you're losing your land and you're poor too.
Right. And so, the other thing is that, okay, what if I did and produce, and that's what we're trying to work towards. What if I produce gas? What if I produce ecological services? And what if I layer that to maybe where I can get equal to or greater than CRP? And then I can get a long-term 20-year lease and put it into that and give the landowner some security on a long-term lease so that now his property is serving society, but he's also getting a return that he can send his kids to school, and he has some. Now, there needs to be, you know, a element of risk for him as well, so he's just not on another welfare program.
Right.
And we need to have an established methodology that says, here's the kind of stuff that we need to produce the resources that society bets. But I think it's doable. And, you know, what we're demonstrating on a small scale is that we are doing it, and it is providing a reasonable return for me and for Smithfield. And what we hope to do then is move that to a greater. And what excites me is that, you know, we have some opportunities in some other states with Smithfield on these projects. And there are other large companies that I can't mention because we are working on some non-disclosure agreements with those companies. But I see this expanding very quickly. And so that really, at age 72, has emboldened me to have hope. Because I got to tell you, I mean, I would come home, and I told you I'd have times really as energetic as I am, getting up in the morning thinking, we are screwed. I mean, this is hopeless. I would come home from developing countries and say, man, our kids and our grandkids, and this is going to happen in America, and it scares the hell out of me.
Yeah. Would you before I leave that idea on the, is you had a thing about scaling, if you got 10, you go to 100, got 100 to 1,000 to make a project scalable.
Right. So, you know, there's a way to do things that mitigates risk on when you scale things. And by that, I mean, you know, a lot of times you start with laboratory experiments. And then once you get done with the laboratory experiments, you say, okay, how do you make, if I can make a quart or something, how do I make 10 quarts? And then how do I go from that and keep scaling it? And so what I saw in the ethanol business is that some of that was just jumped over. And as expensive as that process and complicated as that process was, DuPont spent over $1 billion in Iowa, and the ethanol project they worked on could have probably technically worked, but commercially it was never going to go. Same thing with a company called Avangoa, built a plant in Hugoton, Kansas, second generation ethanol. They were going to make ethanol out of corn stover. And the enzymatic hydrolysis process was extremely complex. And so I actually had an opportunity to participate in that because I had just finished two ethanol plants for them. But when I looked at it, I said they weren't going to scale it. And a project that was going to be $280 million turned almost into $1 billion, and it failed. And so what we've been trying to do on these projects, I've scaled them. And I've said, I'm going to take a small farm, and I'm going to take known technology that has already been integrated in Europe, and it works. And I did that on the first farm. And so what I did as an integrator is I scaled it to a point. And now what we're seeing is that we keep making it bigger. But the other thing we're looking at is that how many farms are a lot smaller. So not, there's two ways to make things economical. One is you can make them very big and scale them up. The other is to make lots and lots of them. Just think of how many cars we make. The reason cars are economical today is that because they build millions of them. And, you know, if we were to build one custom car, like some of the Ferraris and things, they're $1 million.
Right.
Nobody could afford one.
Right.
So what we're looking at is, on the smaller farms, can we scale these processes down to the point where they're economical for these smaller farms? Some of the challenges are that, you know, what we do is we actually take that gas, we run a pipeline, we connect it to an existing distribution line. It costs a lot of money to hook up with that particular distribution systems. So we're trying to work up with the big distributors of the gas on how do we get that to a scale where we don't have to take a whole bunch of farms and aggregate them and then tie that in. Because if it costs $2 million to connect and you have a project that's only worth $1 million, it's never going to work.
Gotcha.
So there are some aggregation issues that we're still working with. But for the most part, we see that now that it works. I had to go to Calgary to meet with Trans-Canadian Pipeline Management quite a few times to convince them. Because really, there was no financial incentive for them to let me tie into their connection point. But once we showed them on this project that we are successful, we're not a risk, and think about, I think one of the epiphanies that the Smithfield people had who are in the farming business, this is a gas business.
Yeah.
I mean, you're talking about some very volatile explosive material. And so we've done a lot of oil and gas business. We understand the safety requirements. We understand all the things that we have to go in steps. And so every time you scale something, you have to look at how does it affect safety? How does it affect economics? How does it affect, you know, the whole process moving forward and the supply chain? And so we've done all that. That's why I feel so good about where we are today. At 72, you know, you think, okay, I'm going to run out of energy. But I'm more energized now than I was 5-6 years ago because I thought I was going to fail. But at this point, you know, failure is not an option, and this thing's moving forward.
Yeah, and you're on to something. I mean, it must feel great to see a realization, no matter how many the challenges still remain, that you what you envisioned actually is, it's coming true on that part.
Yeah, I think whether it's, you know, your own beliefs and your ability to hunt and fish.
Yeah.
We go through these processes where you get to a point, it's not that you're cocky, but you believe in yourself and you know your own limitations, you know your own capabilities. And I'm at that point now where I've eliminated what I've considered to be, you know, some of our weaknesses. And you know, we have a market that looks sound. We have a technology that looks sound. We have a customer base that is some of the, you know, the largest producers of food that believe in this concept. So there's an amount of momentum that I'm really encouraged about. And now it's just getting, thanks to you and other people that are interested in this, it's getting the word out.
Yeah.
And say, look, this is not a threat. This is a huge opportunity to do something different that provides another dimension for farmers and for agriculture and for energy and for the environment and for our wildlife, and look at it in a way that they're not competing.
Right.
They can be symbiotic things that they ought to be, because you can't separate them. There's no way to separate these things and put them in silos and say, I'm going to do this and it's not going to affect that. It all affects each other.
Gotcha. Well, that's it. And I think that's the realization that we're coming to. We may be dragged, you know, kicking and screaming to that realization as a species, but we're coming. So would you go back to stay humble, to your three marks there, and I'll wind this up and let you go?
Well, yeah, I will always stay humble, because I've realized that, you know, life can change on a dime. As I said, the last, you know, I've always felt pretty able physically, but the last 3 or 4 days I've been kind of knocked low a little bit with some of the issues I've had that I took care of when I was a young kid or didn't.
Yeah.
But this thing about humility, like I said, I came from a really humble beginning, and this country has given me an opportunity, and it always takes me back when I saw John F. K. stand in front of all those people and say, don't ask what your country can do for you, but what can you do for your country? And, you know, having this great opportunity to live into this country, and people that, you know, vilify and only harp on what we still have to do better are forgetting how great this country really is.
I hear you.
You know, my father talked about it. He was so humble and privileged to be here and an immigrant to be here. And we're all a nation of immigrants. And, you know, our parents and our forefathers took these huge risks. My whole family didn't speak of English, you know, but we came here on the hope and prayer that my father believed that we could do better than they did. We could get away from war-torn countries. We could get away from some of the persecution that we saw. And that's what a lot of people still want today. And I think we need to figure out how to get this immigration issue resolved and fix our issues. Because we're all immigrants, you know. Even Native Americans who came here at some point weren't here. They got here somehow. So, you know.
Yeah.
So I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you.
This has been great, man.
Give you my little bit of vision on what I think could make things a little bit different, maybe hopefully better.
Yeah.
So,
well, it's a big vision. And I can't tell you this how important it is to me, because you're answering questions that I've had that come from 20 years of reporting on this stuff plus, and some of the answers are right here, buddy. So I'm honored to be here.
Well, there's always, you know, like they say, the devil's in the details, and I think we've worked through a lot of those, and we're still working through a lot. I've engaged with a lot of scientists and universities, and what excites me is that we have a lot of support from some land ag universities, and they don't always have the answer. I mean, they've taken agriculture down the wrong road sometimes too.
Sure.
But I think, as I say, if we collaborate with a lot of smart people and economists and people that really understand agriculture, and it's always like when you look at processes, you say, where's the bottleneck? and you work to that bottleneck,
yeah,
and you get rid of it.
Yeah.
And don't make excuses. No excuses. Get rid of the bottleneck, move on, and get to the next bottleneck. And then you get rid of it. And so that's what this has to be. It has to be a process that we say, what's the bottleneck? Why the hell can't we do this?
Yeah.
Let's not talk about why the hell we can't do it. Let's talk about what do we got to do to do it, make it better.
Gotcha.
And I really think that's how you solve this. And it's a long, you know, I'm hoping that I said 30 million and 30. I'm hoping to live to 100 to see it. I probably won't.
But you're talking about 30 million acres of restored prairie in 30 years?
Yeah. You know, yeah. I don't think we have 30 years, so I'd like to accelerate that. But, you know, I think it has to, you know, take steps. We're working on a couple hundred thousand acres here in the Grand River to use that as a model. And I'm trying to get enough resources together so we could do a couple hundred thousand acres with the Grand River and get some support from our state and Iowa and some agencies and hopefully some wealthy people to move that along. So that would be a great first step.
It would be a huge first step too. Well, thank you so much, Rudy. I just can't tell you how much I appreciate this time and you sharing this vision.
Well, thanks. You brought some amazingly great weather and looks like the spring's going to be here soon. Pretty soon we'll be hearing the peepers and hopefully the quail will be singing and
I feel
the whippoorwills will come back.
I felt the turning when we were out there with the burning crew.
Yeah.
You could feel the intensity of the sun out there burning that frost.
Yeah.
All right. Beautiful place, man.
Thank you, sir. Thanks. Hopefully I can visit you in Montana soon.
Your open invitation.
Hey, this has been Backcountry Hunters and Anglers Podcast and Blast. I'm Hal Herring. We're signing off for this one, but we'll be back in a week or 10 days. And meantime, check out backcountryhunters.org. Get some more podcasts there and see what we're up to. And also, I'm going to be out there wandering around hunting and fishing, wearing out a pair of boots. And I hope you'll be doing the same thing. We're living in God's pocket. We need to celebrate that. Never forget it. And get out there and live it and enjoy it. Hey, thanks a lot, everybody. Talk soon.